Greetings, welcome to church, both physically and online, to our friends around this city and across this land and around the world. Our prayers, best wishes to you, wherever you may be. To those who've gathered in this sacred place, particularly our visitors and those whom we might not have seen for a little while, a special welcome to you. To the young people, a reminder that if you wish to join me and helping with the Eucharist during the course of the service, you can come up and join me, and I'll remind you of that after the greeting of peace. Our hymns are unannounced, but are listed on the boards to my right and left. The service for our visitors begins on page 119 in the prayer book. But please don't worry about following along. Let us, in our singing, in our prayers, in our words, let us carry you along if this is a service that is new to you. Some other remarks. We gather in this place on a day which may go down in history. A few hours ago, the Islamic Republic of Iran launched strikes on Israel. Those drones and missiles are likely to strike Israel in the next hour or so. Here in this church, for 6 months now, we've been praying for peace. Today of all days, we pray for peace. And we pray particularly, I suspect, this morning, that the defense systems of Israel work. Because should they not, the consequences potentially for the world are significant, to say the least. And so it would have been remiss of me not to mention that on this day, and what may be a momentous day for the world. Let us take a moment of silence before our service begins to focus our hearts and minds and intention on the ways of peace. We turn to our prayer book. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God.
Hear these words as recorded in the Acts of the Apostles. Turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. Christ is risen. Alleluia.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Yes.
Let us pray. Lord of life, by submitting to death you conquered the grave. By being lifted upon the cross, you draw all peoples to you. By being raised from the dead, you restore to humanity all that was lost through sin. Be with us in your risen power, that in your word and deed we may proclaim the marvelous mystery of death and resurrection. For all praise is yours now and throughout eternity. Amen. Please make yourselves comfortable for this morning's readings.
Reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When Peter saw it, he addressed the people, "You Israelites, why do you wonder at this, or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we have made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the Holy and Righteous One and asked to have a murderer given to you, and you killed the author of life whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know, and the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. Hear the word of the Lord."
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the first letter of John. Do not love the world or the things in the world. The love of the Father is not in those who love the world, for all that is in the world, the desire of the flesh, the desire of the eyes, the pride in riches, comes not from the Father, but from the world. And the world and its desire are passing away, but those who do the will of God live forever. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. And And so he said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I, myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Answer or respond to one question. In this story today, and I share with you quite a bit of context or background, Luke restates the union between both the historical Jesus and the risen Christ. It is in the telling of this story that the disciples, the students, the followers of Christ himself understand him better, and their minds intellectually are opened afresh to the meaning of their scriptures. In hearing this story, they see that their task in their time is to be witnesses to the message, what they had seen and heard, the resurrection of the Lord. Where were they to do this? They were to begin from Jerusalem, the holiest of holies in that part of the world. For look, it is from there that the victory over death is to be proclaimed to the world. It is not, therefore, a creative or speculative task. So as one author has said, let theologians and preachers alike beware. Perhaps Luke already knew the dangers of speaking on this text. So what has actually happened in this story? The risen Jesus, who searches out the stray disciples in the gospel reading today, is the same Jesus who sat down and ate with the poor and the outcasts. His disciples recognize him in the breaking of bread and eating fish with them. This presence has nothing to do with remembering a dead hero. It is a living presence. And so Luke records some very physical signs that the risen Jesus is truly present in the movement that continues after Jesus had departed. Luke affirms that the messianic reign of peace is really with the one who was crucified on that Easter day, on that Good Friday, that he would rise again from the dead, and that in his name, repentance and forgiveness of sins, those things that separate us from God or where we fall short of his expectations, that these would be preached throughout the world, as I said, starting from Jerusalem. It is the dawn of the new day, as each and every Sunday is meant to be the dawn of a new day for those who gather here in this place and profess his name. This was the day that had been promised in the Hebrew scriptures. The disciples need to proclaim this new reality beyond their holy city. And how were they to do this? By their own liberating practice, how they lived their lives. And so on this new road to all nations, the story of Jesus' practice gets rewoven. Death had barely laid the body of Jesus to rest in the earth when it was raised up. And so from now on, the telling of the practice of Jesus was confided to those who follow him, people like ourselves, on the road of mutual sharing among living bodies. Death has not had the last word. Death could not stop the story. The questions posed by the resurrection appearances are left for all readers to answer for themselves, so the Acts of the Apostles tell us. The Gospel accounts are open to sequels to this very day. The story is not closed. The story is not finished. It has only just begun. Now, as we know from the accounts in the Gospels, as long as Jesus was physically present, the power coming from him and his actions merely dazzled the disciples. But once the disciples have experienced the empowering presence of the Lord, as we hear in this story, it is now their own hands which now transform bodies and return them to life. people to work, to speaking, and to love. The disciples' relationships with others is no longer that of domination, but of walking with others on a journey. The seeing and hearing of the liberating practice of Jesus is to be found in their own practice of life. For the disciples, after the resurrection, the question may well have been this: what is our practice on the level of love, hope, and faith? Rather than, do we actually have the faith? Well, some would claim that times have changed, and in some ways, to our minds and some readers, Luke may seem to skate over difficulties and to be rather simplistic. But I would assert, as scholars and others do, that he grasps the virtues of realism and down-to-earthness, and the way God is concerned with what is real, with what is, rather than with what might just possibly be. So, without wishing to be speculate or be creative, what can we, as the assembled church, apostolic in composition and role, as the people of the resurrection, proclaim? What can we be witnesses to of what is real, rather than what might possibly be? A rhetorical question, I know, but a real question nonetheless, with which we, the community that gathers in this place as the living body of Christ, have real and substantive experiences to proclaim and bear witnesses to. So let us, dear friends, as Easter people, seeing and hearing of the liberating practice of Jesus, as we walk with others on our journey, continue to celebrate the real and living presence of Jesus the Christ in this world by our own practice of life, continuing to express the life of Christ as a community energized by his faith, by our faith and his presence. If we do this, then we too, like the disciples at Emmaus, the disciples of the story, can fulfill our role of testifying to what we have seen and heard, grounded in realism, concerned with what is real, sharing a story that is a continuous, ongoing, creative relationship with a living God, rather than with what might possibly be. That is our call this day, the message of the stories of our scriptures, the message of our prayer for this day. May we respond to it, confident in the knowledge that Christ is risen, hallelujah. He is risen indeed, hallelujah. I invite you, where you are able to do so, to stand with me as we together affirm the faith of the Church Universal. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, the Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, life from life, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Let us sit or kneel as we pray for the world and for the church. For our visitors, we in this community since the 7th of October 2023 have been praying a litany for peace each and every Sunday. The litany for peace may be found on page 194. In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. God of light and salvation, our refuge and strength, we pray for peace from on high and for our salvation. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. God of light and salvation, our refuge and strength, for the peace of the whole world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, let us pray to the Lord. God of light and salvation, our refuge and strength, we pray for peace among our bishops, clergy, and people. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
God of light and salvation, our refuge and strength, we pray for peace among the leaders of the nation and all those who exercise authority throughout the world. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
God of light and salvation, our refuge and strength, we pray for the peace of not only this city and this land, but peace in the Holy Land, in Gaza and Palestine, in Israel, in Yemen, in Iran, Ukraine and Russia, and for all those places racked by war and terror. For every city and community, and for those who live in them in faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
God of light and salvation, our refuge and strength, we pray for our deliverance from all evil, strife, and need. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
it is recorded in the Gospel of John that Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Let us pray. We do not presume to come to your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercy. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crowns under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always ever mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. Christ, our Passover Lamb, has been offered for us. Therefore, we come to celebrate the festival. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith with a sincere and a true heart. Merciful God, our Maker and our Church, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in unison life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Thank you.
are the body of Christ.
His Spirit is with us.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of God's abundance. Thank you.
It's the tradition of this space and 20 years of ministry to invite the younger people to participate in the Lord's Supper, because my experience tells me that our young people innately connect with the sacredness and the mystery of the Eucharist, and from them we can learn a great deal. As always, or in recent times, we gather along the rail, gathering from left to right, following the choir. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom.
Blessed be God. After supper, he took the cup and again, giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of
Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen.
Savior has commanded, proclaiming his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. And looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of our world. Renew us by your Holy Spirit, unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us before your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in him, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father, in songs of never-ending praise. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body, for we all share the common bread. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but I am to say the word, and I shall be with you.
Thank you.
Eternal God, giver of life and the breaking of the bread, we know the risen. May we who celebrate this holy feast walk in his risen light and bring new life to all creation. Father, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, send us out in your spirit to live and work to your praise and glory.
Peace and reconciliation. If you're able to attend, that's wonderful. If not, please just pray for peace and reconciliation throughout the world, and particularly in these most troublesome of times. If you've not yet claimed your Melbourne Anglican Easter edition, and I know Sandra needs a few to home delivery, there's a few left at the entrance to the church. Details of this month's edition will be in the pew bulletin next week. I commend the notice to you as our fundraiser to give thanks to God for the ministry of Kristen and Stacey, who were here with us for 2 years and have now returned to full-time postings in the army. After our fire drill, we will gather at the back of the church for morning tea and particularly to welcome our visitors. We now turn to page 12 in our pew bulletin as we say together our prayer for growth. God of mission, who alone brings growth to your church, send your Holy Spirit to give vision to our planning, wisdom to our actions, joy to our worship, and power to our witness. Help our church to grow in numbers, in spiritual commitment to you, and in service to our local community, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And would you kindly stand for our Easter blessing and dismissal and fire drill, which is for all to participate in. May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you what is pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.
Hello, everyone. Before we commence our fire drill, I would just like to remind you our imaginary fire is this side. So we are going to evacuate through either the side door or the front door, whichever is closest to you. If anybody needs assistance, don't worry. Just stay in your seat and we'll help you. So when you hear the bell ringing and we say, fire, evacuate, please make your way to our assembly point in front of the Evans Hall. Now, can you remain there while we do a head count, just to make sure we have everyone? Fire, evacuate!
Evacuate, evacuate, evacuate. Fire, fire, fire. Fire, fire, fire. Evacuate, evacuate. Fire, fire, fire.
Fire, 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 evacuate, evacuate, 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 fire, 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 evacuate, evac
precepts